This is episode 42. We shall now move on to what Lord has to say to Arjuna's query and even acquisition. Lord says, first of all, the next six slokas, six verses, are talking about action and life are so closely connected that it is difficult to say the difference between action and life. In other words, life itself is action. Whether we breathe, whether we speak, whether we keep quiet, sleep, whatever we are doing, we are in action. Actions are not necessarily physical. The mental thoughts that propels us to do action, so these are all action. Man cannot simply live without action. Even a saint, when he's meditating, he's breathing, and breathing is an action. So in the next six slokas, Sri Krishna Bhagavan is pointing out the importance of action and inevitability of action, because we are born, the body is made of action, the creation is itself an action of God. Everything is moving in a circle through His energy. So action is something in our very blood. There is nothing stable within the field of creation except God Himself. So let's see. And another thing I notice before we enter into His reply, that no matter what others say about you or your message, you always keep cool. In other words, don't lose your head, don't worry about what others say. You mind your business with what you have to say. Otherwise, 10 different people will talk 10 different things to you, and you try to listen to all the 10, you will be confused as to what you have to say. So sometimes it is wise to close your ears to what other people talk about you, particularly when they try to confuse you, or when they make adverse comments that are not really truthful or not right, but they have made a statement. And we cannot shut up anybody from giving their opinion. We cannot tape somebody's mouth. And yet we just always argue why somebody made this comment, why did he say that. Well, everybody has a right to say what they want. We have a right to take or not to take is given to us. That freedom we have. One time when somebody abused Buddha Bhagavan, and of course Mirabai's life, she was being abused by the in-laws all the time. And yet she kept her cool because she was truthful, she didn't have to worry about it. The truth will speak itself. But when Buddha Bhagavan was abused by somebody, then he kept quiet, he was smiling, he didn't say anything. Then his disciple says, Lord, how come he is abusing you so much without your fault? You have not done harm to him. You, as a matter of fact, prayed for him, and yet he is abusing, and you are smiling. And he said, well, he has abused me, but I have not accepted his abusing. So it is up to me whether I should accept what he talks. If a dog is barking, and if we start barking at him, we become dog too. So there is no point in arguing with people when you know that they have their opinion. It is their opinion, you have your own opinion, and the best thing is to find the right opinion. It could be that both of us are wrong. And that is why we go to a saint or Gita or Meera, somebody who is 100% right, there is no question about it, there is no 99.9. This is a path of perfection, and saints are perfect. They are the manifestation of perfection, that is God. That is why we insist that we learn Gita, we know its original slokas and its translations as close as it can, so that you can make up your own judgment by reading and understanding the slokas. Any explanation or commentary is merely to help, and it is a person's experience or opinion. Saints don't insist on their opinion, they insist on truth. Fortunately, their opinions and truths are always in harmony. They are 180 degrees, they are interfacing always. So if they say it is my opinion, you better take it that it is the truth, because they have no opinion of their mind. They are Atman, and Atman has no opinion. Atman is existence. It is, period. It's not talking, not arguing, not debating. It is the mind that is debating and talking. Atman, simply like sun, exists, throws out the light, and does what he wants to do, unaffected by whether we like it or not, whether we accept it or not, whether we complain or not. It just keeps on going. So the truth does that. Love continues to do that. Truth continues to do that. And we should continue to do that as long as we know it is according to the law of God. So then, one of the beautiful things is the Lord is keeping his cool. He is not arguing with him why he has accused him or anything like that. Even though normally a person would say that Arjuna is accusing the person who is trying to help him by saying that he is responsible for his confusion, while Krishna had nothing to do with the confusion or the war that the Kauravas and Pandavas had to undergo. It was the greed of Duryodhana, and Pandavas had to fight, and they had decided that it was justified, and now he is blaming Sri Krishna for confusing him. Strange as it is, this is the world in which we live, so try not to get too much confused or depressed when people give comments about you. They disagree with you. They may even speak ill of you. You remain unaffected. That is what we learn in the second chapter. Samatvam yoga ucchate. Let the world say anything. Let the waves of the ocean be higher and low. We try to surf it. Our boat should remain on the top, and we know how to keep our boat on the top. That is what Gita is teaching. So keeping his cool then, Sri Krishna Bhagavan, he did that in the second chapter too. If you recall on the slok number 11, Ashochyan Anvashochyatvam, he smiled and he then gave him the message, even though Arjuna was arguing. Always keep cheerful. Keep yourself balanced, so that you can give the best advice that you have, or you can perform best whatever you have to do. But if you are upset and if you are confused and you have argument going on within you, then you are going to fail in performing what you have to perform. So these are some of the things we learn in from the Gita. A very practical approach in life. We worldly people waste so much of time, even between husband and wife and children. We go on talking at each other, nobody is listening, nobody is trying to find out who is right and wrong. All the parties say we are right, and they still they know they have confusion, we have pain in the family, we are not as happy as we should, and yet nobody wants to give in. Amazing as it is, it's like having a disease, we are suffering, we have pain, and yet we don't want to admit that I am sick or I can be sick. Strange is the power of ignorance or maya. Now the Lord says, Loke asmin dvivida nishta pura prokta maya anaga jnana yogena sankhyanam karma yogena yoginam. He simply straight away tells that in this world there are two paths. Nishtha, determined paths that you can follow. I have said this before in ancient times. He Anaga, he is calling Arjun that he is spotless. In the sense that Arjun is innocent, he is on the right side. But we human beings do come under influence of ignorance. God gives us the concession God recognizes our weaknesses. He doesn't expect us more than what we are capable to perform, and yet He sees our good points. So I think in life also we should try to look at the good point of the other people before we look at their vices. Arjuna has a lot of vices right now, being depressed, yet Shri Krishna Bhagavan constantly is trying to uplift him by reminding that his life has been according to the law of the worldly people. He has not deceived anybody, he has not cheated or promised something and he didn't fulfill his promise. Pandavas were known to be the good Aryans and Sattvic people. So Shri Krishna reminds him that you are a desirable family man. I am proud of you, but we need to do something at this time which is not very desirable. So we can say that he is good, but in the present circumstances, in the present situation, he has a problem. So that takes us to another situation, that don't brand anybody permanently that he is weak or he is useless or that he is always lying or that he is never keeping his promise or he is so and so. People can change, people have opportunities to change, we have no way of knowing it, and we will be responsible if we comment without thoughts, permanently branding anybody according to our nature. So we should not do that. That is one beautiful thing we learn today. Don't brand anybody what you think they are. They will be different and you will be sorry. You may only talk about their action if you didn't like it, a particular action or a particular thought, but don't brand that person that he is terror. His attitude and his particular action is terror. But he is not a terrorist because he may have good aspects in him also. And when we look at him that way, he may even turn against terror and turn out to be a better person because he heard that he can be better. So we should look at the actions and thoughts but not brand the person, because we know that changing in the Prakriti, everybody can change, persons can change when they suffer, and we should give an opportunity, and we have no right anyway in the first place to brand people because of our own attitude. Sufficient if we brand ourselves or we think about ourselves and continue our duties. So now then Lord says that in the ancient time, means from the day the Prakriti was made, the creation was made, Lord has put in creation two paths. One of knowledge, what we talk about Sankhya Vidya, and another is Karma Yoga. In other words, knowledge and karma, action. These are the only two paths. In the knowledge path, there is a meditation. Meditation means focusing. Meditation simply means listening with 100% attention. That is meditation for worldly people. And we know we don't do that, but that is meditation. And karma yoga is to perfectly execute our duties, kushalta, means with expertise, we have talked about it. To perform our action expertly is karma yoga. So then that kind of karma, performing it on the time, appropriately, with full zest, all our energy and know-how, without any excuses, and immediately, not saying, well, after 1 hour. If you have to do it as soon as you can, without finding any excuses. Then that will become a karma yoga. And we will see about karma yoga. So Lord now is saying there are two paths, path of knowledge, path of action. And every time he attaches the word yoga, the path of jnana yoga, knowledge yoga, and path of action yoga, karma yoga. Yoga is always kept in mind that our whole purpose is to become divine, move towards divinity, to join the company of the saints, just like the Pandavas have tried to join Shri Krishna Bhagavan. Now he says in the next slok, na karmanam anarambhat naishkarmya purushasnute na cha sanyasanat eva siddhim samadhigacchati. He says, by not starting action, you do not become naishkarmya. Naishkarmya is a beautiful word. Naishkarmya means even though we perform the action, we are called actionless. In the sense that when we perform an action, we had no selfishness or no desire for any results. So we did not come in bondage of the karma or the action. So we remain free in spite of doing the karma, because karmas normally bind us. As soon as we have desires for results, we are slave of the karma. And here naishkarmya means though performing, we remain independent. Though we want to ride a horse, we are riding a horse and not allowing the horse to ride us. We are working freely, with freedom and without anxiety, being the master of our actions, then we are naishkarmya, we are not the slave. So Lord here says that by not doing karmas, you don't remain free from karma. But by doing the karma, you can remain free from karma, and that means you do not get attached to it and keep focus on the karma with expertise and according to the law of the Lord. Selfless activities. Selfless activity is the goal. So Lord says that by not starting the karma, you do not achieve the state of naishkarmya. That means really Brahma Nirvanam. In a sense, it is Brahma Nirvanam. It is that state, ultimate state, where whether we work or we don't work, we are free and we are just at peace. But that state does not come by abandoning the karma, but showing that you can perform your duties in the world, you have done it right, without getting angry, without getting bored, without trying to run away from your duties, but doing your best and pay for it, what you have asked for, whether it's family life or whether it is job or car. When we do it lovingly, our obligatory duties, then someday we will achieve that state of naishkarmya. Though we perform the action, we don't come under the bondage. Simply by running away from our duties, like Arjun wants to do it, there is no chance for him to have naishkarmya siddhi. Nacha sannyasanateva siddhim samadhi gacchati. Again, he repeats the same thing, that by renouncing the actions, one does not become perfect, or one does not become balanced. Samadhi gacchati means balance. And siddhi here means, in Gita, siddhi always means self-realization. There is nothing short of self-realization as siddhi. Some people have certain types of siddhis, of course. When we concentrate, we may be able to read somebody's hand and all, but that is all sometimes or most of the time a vigna or obstacle. One should not stop on the way. If we are going to San Francisco, we just don't stop anywhere until we reach San Francisco. At least we don't forget our goal. And we keep on moving. So same way, in this path of self-realization, there is no siddhi that we want except to realize ourselves. So remember that we should not stop at any place. Let people praise us or abuse us, or they say that you may be godlike and all this. Don't listen to anything until you have realized God. All these things are vignas, they are obstacles. And Lord says that the real siddhi is samadhi gacchati, to become balanced or to realize God or self-realization. However, man is very helpless. Though we know this thing, man's helplessness is what we see in the next slok. And it says, nahi kaschit kshanam api jatu tishtati akarmakrut karyatehi avashah karma sarvah prakruti jaihi gunaihi. In this world, nobody can stay even for a second without performing some actions. One cannot be lazy. Even when we are sleeping, we are, as I said, performing action. We are breathing, and breathing or pumping our blood, it is an action. So without action, we cannot survive. So as long as we have the body, we are doing the actions, whether we like it or not. The question is whether we are performing actions that will lead us towards our goal, or whether they are actions which are just neutral, or whether the actions are taking us backward. But actions, yes, we have, we must. We will perform, we are performing, because prakruti means, kruti means karma or action, and the Lord has made the creation out of Prakriti, that means all of us have been given that momentum of action. Until we perform the action the way he is saying, we will not be going beyond actions. This may sound little strange, but that is what we need to learn in spirituality. We must perform, but do not be selfish. Think of others and try to help others. That will be the message as we move on. Karyate hi avashah karma sarvah prakruti jayi gunaihi. The gunas or this nature, and there are three kinds of nature in Prakruti. This is slok number 5, I think I mentioned this 4 and 5, or I think we have started this last 5 or 6 slokes, starting from 3 to 8, where we are talking about two paths. Presently, we are talking about slok 5, in which man is helpless, where he says that all of us are born out of Prakruti, and Prakruti is made up of three gunas, or three natures. What he is going to talk about, tamas, rajas and sattva, and we will have to get familiar with it. It is a language of Gita, it is a language of spirituality. There are three kinds of nature we all human beings have. One time we may be in one fold, another time we may be changed, or we may be a mix of all this. But certainly we are falling in one of these category, at one time tamas, rajas and sattva. I think I have said before that tamas is like an animal life, laziness, negligence, carelessness, not performing our duties as a human being, even to maintaining the body. The rajas nature is based on lust and greed, which we have talked often, and 99% of the people probably fall in that. And sattva is to go beyond and have a noble life, a noble way of thinking, eating, acting, performing our duties, and peacefully, without care and concern, without haste. Haste is a rajasic attitude. We will be talking about that later. So then, these three natures of human beings, we are all subject to that. We are helpless, we have no choice, so don't try to struggle and find a way that by running away on the top of the mountain, you will be out of these three gunas. There is no place on this earth, and on the sun and on the moon, or in any other galaxy, where we will be free from action. Because all galaxies are moving. The whole world is moving. So movement is our nature. Then how to control the movement, or how to understand the movement, and how to make the best use of it to our advantage, and to the advantage of everybody else, is our goal. Our goal is not how to avoid the karmas. Our goal is, if we have to do it because God has made that way, God wants it that way, that is His kingdom, that is He is the king, we are His servants, we are His praja or people, we have to simply do what He says. And that is always in our interest anyway. Mother never tells anything to her son or children that would hurt them. As a matter of fact, God alone is our well-wisher in this world. We ourselves are not well-wisher of ourselves. I do not know how others can help us to move on to our good. So in this slok then, we have been told that inevitably we must work. Nobody should try to think that I can retire and lie down under the tree, because that way also we will get tired. Even the kings who don't have to work for bread, they have to do some exercise, so they go on riding the horse, play polo, or some games, you know, or go to shikar, you know, hunting. So they have to keep themselves tuned. God has made the body that even if you are a king and you don't have to work for your money or your needs, you still have to keep your body tuned. So see how helpless we are. Even a king has to keep his body fit and working. That is a work. Now even today we are people who have money and we are overeating, we have to work, so we go to exercise rooms, I don't know what they call them, but we have invented those places, President's Club and all that, and where we have machines, just like monkeys have machines like trees where they jump around, and we jump around on those machines and keeping ourselves fit, whether it is a swimming pool or some machines or whatever, or even sports. Somehow we will have to keep ourselves fit. The best thing is to perform our actions in life every day keeping our house clean, cooking, working in the yard and in the house, and on our job, of course, this will be the best. So here in Sloka 5, we have been taught about inevitability of action. So let nobody say that he will be able to live without actions, or he can retire in the cave. Karma indriyani sanyamya ya aste mansa smaran indriyarthan vimudatma mithyachara savuchyate. This is a wonderful sloka telling us something we ought to have known, that those who try to outwardly control their senses, like we sometimes fast outwardly, but inside we wish that we had a chance to eat, and often we will, if there is nobody in the house, we'll open the refrigerator and put one rasagulla in our mouth. So this is called hypocrisy. We outwardly say that we don't eat, we are fasting today, but our mind is constantly thinking of eating and waiting for a chance that 24 hours is over or midnight. When the day is over, then 1 minute after midnight we start eating, because now we have said we have finished 24 hours of fasting. In short, our mind is all the time thinking of eating while we are saying outwardly that we are fasting. So Lord says that those who outwardly pretend to be something, but in their mind they are thinking of something else which is opposite, then these are the hypocrites. And certainly one thing that God does not like is hypocrisy. We may be weak, we may be even terrorist, we may have murdered somebody, there will be prostitutes all around, does not matter to God. But don't be a mithyachar, don't lie, don't go beyond what you say one thing and do another thing. Do everything openly and God will forgive us. This is one of the worst things that the worldly people are doing, always saying something and planning something else, or in their mind they have something else, so they have secret talks. And this is one of the worst things. Lord says that those who say something in the mind, do something else outwardly, are hypocrites, and hypocrites have no place in this world. You may be weak, you may be ignorant, whatever else weakness we may have, God says, I can help you. But I cannot help, or you are beyond help, when you are a hypocrite. Let's look at an example of a guy who is sleeping. If a guy is sleeping sound, that is, like we are saying, he's ignorant, you know, he's in the dark, he's sleeping. If he is sleeping, we can wake him up by kicking him or putting cold water or shaking him up, he will wake up. But if a guy is pretending to sleep with his eyes closed, and if we kick him, he is not going to get up because he is pretending to sleep and he doesn't want to get up. So this is what we mean, that a sleeping man can be awakened, but a man who is pretending to sleep, he doesn't want to be awakened, he cannot be awakened. So in the world also, if you don't want to be awakened, you don't want to realize God, you don't want peace, you don't want joy and happiness, and I don't know how anybody would say they don't want happiness and joy. If you don't want this, then you can do what you want. But hypocrisy is something we must avoid as the first thing in this world. Mithyachar is something that Lord has disapproved once and for all. All other vices, he knows they are not good, they are opposite to virtues, but then he knows that by virtues we can overcome the vices. But for a hypocrite, there is no possibility of overcoming the vices, because he doesn't want to overcome, he refuses to do it. While the ignorant people may want to try to do something, then they will be able to achieve their goal. So please remember one thing, that let's not be hypocrite, let's just say what we mean, let everybody know what we are, and we have every right to be what we are doing. Nobody, we don't need to explain anybody why we are doing this. God and we alone know what is right and wrong, and we are responsible to God only. So let's not be hypocrite, let's show ourselves as we are inside and out. That will be the finest wisdom we can learn from this sloka. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Tat Sat. All other vices, He knows they are not good, they are opposite to virtues, but then he knows that by virtues we can overcome the vices. But for a hypocrite, there is no possibility of overcoming the vices because he doesn't want to overcome. He refuses to do it. While the ignorant people may want to try to do something, then they will be able to achieve their goal. So please remember one thing, that let's not be hypocrite. Let's just say what we mean. Let everybody know what we are. And we have every right to be what we are doing. Nobody, we don't need to explain anybody why we are doing this. God and we alone know what is right and wrong. And we are responsible to God only. So let's not be hypocrite. Let's show ourselves as we are, inside and out. That will be the finest wisdom we can learn from this slok. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Tat Sat.